And we are going to go for our next speaker, that is Giulia Grancini. Giulia, are you there? I know she's ready.
Yes, hi, Monica.
Oh, hi. I can see you.
This is going to be very brief. I would like to welcome Giulia Grancini from the University of Pavia in Italy. And she is our seventh speaker, so we have one more to go after Giulia. Giulia?
Thank you.
Thank you, Giulia. She's going to be talking about dynamical 2 and 3D interfaces, about the Perovskite Solar Cell Stability, what's behind. Thank you, Giulia, for being here.
Okay, here we are. So let me thank Monica and Zakia for organizing this brilliant initiative. I'm very happy to be here with you. And now let's discuss a little bit more about my work, which relates on these 2D and 3D perovskites. The motivation of our work sits in the transition to green energy and to new solutions, where solar became the new king of electricity. This is what the World Energy Outlook stated, released just a couple of days ago. So solar energy can be a key player, covering up to 30% of the global energy demand by 2050. And of course, as I said, this puts a lot of motivation into our work as a scientist working in renewable energies. Perovskites, there's no time now to again mention how this field emerged and moved so quickly in the last decade. It was quite impressive, especially comparing to the development of any other existing solar technologies. Why? Mainly because hybrid perovskite offered the potential for being a very low cost solution for photovoltaics, but also very high efficient. And the low cost is mainly related, as we already heard, to the easy and low cost, low temperature methods that are used for the deposition of these materials. So we have the low cost, we have the high efficiency, but there is nowadays a severe issue which hampers the commercialization of these materials, which is the stability. Indeed, hybrid perovskite suffer from degradation when exposed to a humid condition, oxygen, UV light, thermal stress. Basically, the three-dimensional structure can degrade, and then you see here that the black phase of the materials turns back to yellow. So this is one of the main challenges that all the community working on perovskite is facing in the last years. We are working on a different concept, as Professor Loi reviewed in her presentation. We are working also on two-dimensional perovskites. Why? Because two-dimensional perovskite offer the potential for being a stable solution within the family of hybrid perovskites. So in this case, you have single inorganic layers which are spaced by these large organic cations, which can be many different organic cations, such as phenylethyl ammonium, that's the most studied one. And they are very interesting because, as I mentioned, they have a much higher stability with respect to the 3D perovskite. You can see here in the image, they don't suffer from degradation when exposed to water, and that results in much more stable devices. However, as already mentioned in the previous talk, they are excitonic in their behavior. They absorb in a much narrow region, so they don't possess ideal properties for photovoltaics. The family of 2D perovskite is very large, as recently explained by Professor Loi. We know very well that in this family, you do have what we can call pure 2D perovskites, where single inorganic layers are spaced by these large organic cations. But then if the inorganic layers are held together like two or three in the N equal to two or three configuration, because you also use small cations, you see that you end up with a very large family of perovskites, of 2D perovskites. So on one side, you increase the stability. On the other side, you moving from pure 2D to pure 2D, you improve the efficiency of the device. So working on these quasi 2D, this mixed phases 2D perovskite is, as we have just seen now, a very attractive strategy to improve the stability of the device without compromising the efficiency. So for instance, using N equal to more than one, 3, 4, 5, 20, you can really improve the efficiency of your device. This is mainly because you are basically shifting your absorption edge by shortening the band gap of your materials, going from N equal to one to N more than one. My research works on a different concept. So in my team, we are using the 2D perovskites, but we are combining them with the 3D perovskites, trying to develop efficient and stable devices using a 3D perovskite as active bulk layer and covering the 3D perovskite with a very, very thin layer of N equal to one 2D perovskites. This is the concept that, however, comes with a very important question. The question is to unveil the structure function relationship behind this, and more specifically, how the interface of the 2D and the 3D in terms of structure and processes can affect the device operation. So in my talk, I would like to show you some general observation on these 2D-3D interfaces, and then I present you a couple of study cases with thiophene-based 2D perovskites. First of all, we want to engineer a 3D and 2D clean bilayer interface. That's the first challenge, engineering the deposition method. So how to have to get this device structure? So basically we use a three-dimensional perovskite with a mixed halide mixed cation system, as you can see here, using an excess of lead iodide. This is crucial because the lead iodide excess we verify is mainly located at the top surface of your 3D perovskites. So basically you use a two-step process, and when you use take as a second step the big cation for the 2D perovskites, you just simply deposit the large cation on top of the 3D, which in situ reacts with the excess of lead iodide, and it can form this very, very thin overlayer of 2D perovskites on top of the 3D. There are different ways to verify the presence of this thin 2D layer on top of the perovskites. And of course, one of the simplest is just to take in the photoluminescence, monitoring the top and the bottom surface. And you can see that the wide bandgap emission from the 2D perovskites, around 540 nanometers, is observable only upon top side excitation. There is no emission when we excite from the top, from the bottom, and these can gives evidence of the presence of this 2D layer on top. Of course, using this 2D layer on top, the main purpose was to make the surface of the 3D more robust and more water repellent. So we are here tackling the stability challenge. And this is an example of one of the first studies we did with the phenylethyl ammonium-based 2D cations. And you can see here that the stability is really improved. This is particularly nice given the fact that we are measuring the stability both in air using an encapsulated device, but also under inert conditions. So you see the stability is improved, and you can relate this improvement to this more robust surface that is more water repellent using this 2D layer. But on top of that, it's quite remarkable to also highlight that the improved stability does not compromise, in this case, the efficiency. Indeed, in general, we can fabricate devices with around 20% efficiency, and overall, we always see an improve in the VOC when we cover the 3D with the 2D perovskites. This is quite a general observation that we have been observing for many different 2D cations. I will go back to this point later. So again, the hot question here is, what's the structure to function relationship? Can we understand more about the interface structure and the interface processes? Talking about interface structure, the first point was to try to understand how this 2D perovskite lies on top of the 3D. So we also look at GVAX data. And as you can see here, they qualitatively are telling us that basically the 2D perovskite is oriented on an horizontal plane on top of the 3D perovskites. And this is a very general behavior. And I just recall what Professor Loy has explained us before, showing that they have this preferential orientation on top of the 3D with this horizontal stacking. Then let's go a little bit more into the understanding the interface properties and processes of these. I have highlighted that generally speaking, when you have the 2D perovskites on top of the 3D, you generally observe an increase in the open circuit voltage of your device. This relates to the fact that with the 2D perovskites on top, you are improving also the quality of the interface. Basically, you are reducing the surface traps at the interface. For instance, measurements from time-resolved photoluminescence analysis and also combined with time-resolved microwave photoconductivity, which monitors the photo-induced charge carriers and their dynamical evolution, shows very similar results. So basically, when we excite here just the 3D, not the 2D, you see that in this bilayer structure, you have the photoluminescence lifetime gets longer. This is a very common observation for this bilayer structure. And along with that, if we monitor for the same system, the time-resolved microwave photoconductivity, you do also see an elongation of the lifetime. It's important then to model a little bit this system just by taking a simple kinetic model equation where you have your perovskites, and then you see here basically the main parameter we are interested at is the K2, which is the bimolecular recombination rate. What we observed is that when we have this bilayer structure, the bimolecular electron hole recombination at the surface is retarded. So the 2D perovskites has this important impact on reducing the number of the background charges and then inducing a surface passivation. That can explain, among other reasons, the general improve in the VOC that we always observe. Now, these are kind of more general observations we have been making on these 3D-2D structures, which are very interesting, not for the stability and the efficiency of the devices. But I would like now to focus is more on the interface structure and processes, looking at a quite recent family of organic cations, which I highlight here. They are based on the thiophene core, and we use them as organic cations as spacers for the two-dimensional perovskites. First of all, using these thiophene-based cations, you see they are pretty similar in shape, in structure. They only slightly differ in terms of the length or the position you see of the tail, but they are quite similar in shape and in the chemical composition. Using these cations, we form, using the same engineering deposition method, this 3D, 2D bilayer. And again, you can see that GVAX show us that in a qualitative picture, they always oriented parallel with respect to the 3D. But now the point is, can we understand a little bit more about the true interface between the 2D and the 3D? So to do that, we have analyzed in combination photoluminescence and XRD of these bilayer structure. And I would like to address this very interesting point. As you can see, this is the photoluminescence, these are the photoluminescence spectra with the top excitation. You do see the photoluminescence around 500 nanometers from the 2D perovskites. However, they are different. Indeed, you see that for the green and red cations, you mainly see an emission at around 520. This is especially true for the 2T AI. While for the other cations, you do see also an emission at a longer wavelength site. This also happens for the XRD, where you do see a clean signature of n equal to 1 2D perovskites for the green and the red cations, but that's not the case for the other. So basically, these measurements are telling us that the interface is much more complex than what we thought. It's a graded interface. Indeed, the red-shifted emission is an indication that there is a formation of n equal to 2 phase of 2D perovskites. So there is a graded interface for the TMI cation-based 2D perovskites, but this is not the case for the 2T AI cations, where only n equal to 1 phase results from this investigation. So a small change in the cations turns into a change of the two-dimensional interfacial structure. How can this impact on device performances? Talking about efficiency, they all have around 20% efficiency. These data are based on around 100 device statistical analysis. But the very important point I would like to address is the stability. So when talking about this, about the stability of these cells, you can see that there is a huge difference. For the 2TI-based cations, this stability is very good and much more improved with respect to the other cases. So this is interesting because for these devices, they are based on the 2TI cations, which is the one that shows only n equal to 1 phase. So the answer is, can it be, well, actually the question is, can it be that if we have a stable n equal to 1 2D perovskites, this is the reason of the higher stability in the device. That's quite of a big jump. So let's monitor the stability of the material first. So looking at the material, here I compare the TEI cations with the TMI, fresh thin film and an aged material, you can see that immediately for the n equal to 1, the emission is stable, while for the other one, you see that from the emission at a higher wavelength, we have a change in the emission, a change in the color of the materials, and it goes towards a higher wavelength. The same happens if we accelerate this aging process by a thermal stress at 50 degrees, you can clearly see that for the TAI, the emission is locked and we have n equal to 1 phase. For the other cations, we do have a structural change of the materials going from n equal to 1 perovskites to n equal to 2 phases. So there is a restructuring of the interface of the 2D perovskites, which is the key behind the device stability. This is also important. It's also important to notice that when you have a pure n equal to one phase, that also it's a robust interface and can block then the ion migration at the interface. So interface structure is crucial for device stability. And then in the last minutes, I would like to give you an example on how interface processes are also crucial for the device stability and performances. So we focus now the attention on three different thiophene cations, which they are very similar and they only differ because you have these different elements. So it's chloride, bromide, or iodine in the tail, in the salt tail. So we made devices out of that. And you can see here that in all cases, you have efficiency, again, around 20-21% in the best cases, with a very nice open circuit voltage. So that's the point, again, higher circuit voltage when you have the 2D on top. And for the bromide-based, the TMA cations, you have a VOC close to 1.2, which is among the highest for these devices, without compromising the fill factor. That's also important. Not also that there is good stability for the bromide TMA-based cations. So we wanted to explore a little bit more the interface processes. And first we measure the photoluminescence of the device and the quantum yield of the device. And from the photoluminescence quantum yield, we also wanted to derive the quasi-Fermi level splitting, which comparing the neat material and the devices. This is crucial to assess the relative contribution of the bulk and of the interfacial recombination loss. So it's important to notice, first of all, that these materials, they all show very high PL quantum yield, up to 5% in the neat material, which is among the highest reported for pure 2D perovskites, and 2% for the devices. Now, when monitoring and comparing the quasi-Fermi level splitting of the device with the neat material and the device VOC, we can, first of all, understand that already with the neat material, you see here the triangles, the addition of the 2D improves the quasi-Fermi level splitting of the bulk, indicating that they act as a trap passivant elements in agreement with the other measurements I showed you before. In addition, when they increase with respect to the 3D with the addition of the 2D, as I mentioned to you now. And then when looking at the device quasi-Fermi level splitting with the 2D, you see here, they show minimal energy losses, which can be related to very low interfacial recombination losses. That is key to really improve the device performances in terms especially of device VOC. And a very important point is that the cation based by the bromide element, which shows the highest open circuit voltage, equals, you see, the quasi-Fermi level of these materials is the same for the neat material and for the complete device. So with this passivation using these bromide-based cations, the 2D layer enables to reach the quasi-Fermi level potential of the neat perovskites. So there is no losses, no interfacial losses, and this is, of course, very, very interesting to push and to give clear direction on how to push a device optimization. So just to conclude, I would like to mention that we believe that interface engineering with these methods can be a powerful tool to improve device robustness and performances. 2D perovskites are very fascinating materials and they interface with the 3D effects, dynamical behavior, VOC, charge distribution, interface recombination, which all together impact on device performances. So a simultaneous control on interface structure, processes, energetics is really important to derive a clear direction to optimize the device. So with this, let me thank the people involved in the project, still my PhD that are still at the PFL in the group of Nasiruddin, my team at the University of Pavia, collaborators, fundings, and you for your kind attention.
Giulia, thank you very much for a very interesting talk, as always. We have one question, if you go down to the Q&A window.
Yeah. Are the stability measures done in controlled environment? Okay, thanks Francesca for this important question. The stability are done in a controlled environment, so in a chamber with a controlled atmosphere, or we also do them in air, but they are encapsulated. This is the answer.
There is another question.
Can you comment on how the polaronic nature of charge carriers in 2D and free charge carriers in 3D interact with each other at the interface? That's an important point, but it's also important to understand that the 2D perovskite is not photoexcited in our 3D device structure. So you only excite the 3D. So when we are talking about the charges, they are the charges which are created in the 3D and then they are transferred to the 2D perovskites. An important question would rather be, how is the charge transport then in the 2D perovskites and how is the energetics at the interface? And those are, I think, the hot questions which are trying to address right now, even if it's quite challenging. There is another one for the TI-based devices. There seems to be a recovery type of behavior during the lifetime testing, like soaking. Do you know the reason for this? Yeah, I know that there is this kind of recovering. It's very small, so I don't know the answer for that. But what we can see, what we know is that there is a kind of dynamical behavior happening at the interface. In any case, the TI cation is stable in this sense. So this is the main difference with respect to the other cations. Monica, should I keep reading?
Our last question, because we are running a little bit late, yeah. Okay? We can send you the question afterwards by email. Can you answer the last one?
Have you tried also having a 2D perovskite below the 3D as well as above? This is a very common question. The point is the energetics. If the energetic does not fit, that you cannot do that.
Okay. I'm sorry, we have to stop here. I know people have a lot of questions for you, Giulia. We thank you very much for a very nice talk.
Thank you, Monica.
And thank you, Giulia.